This is space-time, or at least it's the way I see it. Here's why it's better than any visual you've ever seen. Hey, crazies. If you've been following the Science Asylum for a while, you've probably heard of space-time. No, not the YouTube channel PBS Space-Time, like actual space-time. What we're talking about is modern relativity. It's the idea that measurements like space, time, speed, energy, and a whole list of other properties are relative to the observer. There are only a few specific measurements that are the same no matter what. Albert Einstein himself pioneered these ideas in 1905, but his arguments were, let's just say they weren't very rigorous. He was big into thought experiments with tangible examples like trains, and that's pretty common among physicists. If it wasn't for mathematicians, our models wouldn't make any significant progress. That's where math extraordinaire Hermann Minkowski comes into play. My boy Hermann published his own papers a few years after Einstein, making significant improvements to Einstein's work, not the least of which was treating time as just another dimension.
You mean like invaders from the fifth dimension?
Sci-fi really ruined a lot of words. Okay, fine. Consider this box. It has a length, a width, and a height. Each of those measurements is considered a dimension of the box. But the reason that box has three dimensions is because of something much more fundamental. Even if the box didn't exist, the space it occupied has those same three dimensions. Space itself has the dimensions. Of course, those arrows are just mathematical representations of the dimensions, not the dimensions themselves. It doesn't really matter how big we make our increments, what orientation they're in, or even where the center is. We draw those arrows for our own sake. Anyway, for hundreds of years, we thought of time as its own unique thing. Space was measured by rulers, and time was measured by clocks. Good old Al didn't even break from this tradition when he became famous for relativity. His observers were holding rulers and clocks. Minkowski changed everything. But if he was going to treat time as a dimension, he'd have to figure out how to draw it first. Mathematically speaking, any additional dimension is going to have to be at 90 degrees to each of the other three dimensions. And there's no room for that in this picture. Minkowski took the practical approach. Let's say we suppress a dimension, so we pretend the three-dimensional space is actually two-dimensional. Or another way to think of it, we're just looking at a cross-section of space. With the dimension open now, we're free to use it for time instead. Imagine a different cross-section of space for each moment in time. This is a bit misleading though, conceptually speaking. It gives you the impression that everyone shares a universal now and that all of time is predetermined. The so-called block universe. Absolutely ridiculous. Minkowski knew this wasn't the case, but he didn't really care that much. He was going for something mathematically useful, which is why he doubled down and suppressed two dimensions instead of one, resulting in the famous Minkowski diagram, or what most of us just call a space-time diagram. Rather than working with rulers, clocks, and trains, what Minkowski did was treat the universe as a four-dimensional hyperbolic space-time, and then just ignored two of the three space dimensions. How can he get away with that? Well, most things aren't taking advantage of all three dimensions anyway. This car is only moving in one of them. The same goes for this falling apple. Pendulums, projectiles, and planetary orbits are all two dimensions. Obvious three-dimensional motion is actually quite uncommon, at least without conscious intervention. But is it actually that useful to suppress dimensions? Oh, yeah. Minkowski used this idea to derive everything Einstein had. Plus a few new things he couldn't. Just made a video about that one a couple months ago if you're interested. Link in the doobly-doo. While I could fanboy about the Minkowski diagram all day, it does have its drawbacks. I think we can do better.
You have the audacity to think you can do better than the greats?
Yeah, I do. But no matter how this turns out, I'm sure you'll all share your opinions in the comments later. Okay, let's do this. We always get so caught up with this list of relative measurements because they're so interesting to talk about. But relativity, like any good model, is based on the universal invariance, not the relative measurements. I think we should build our visual the same way, around the stuff that everyone agrees on, the events. See, space-time isn't one big thing, it's an unimaginably large collection of smaller things called events. In other words, the things that happen. Seriously, that's all they are. I know physics has this tendency to use words in weird ways, but this is not one of those situations. Imagine you're leaving your home to go to work. You leaving is an event. And you might assign some properties to that event, like a location or a time. A later event would be you arriving at work, and you assign that event with its own location and time, at least within your perception of reality. On a typical space-time diagram, that would look something like this. Each of the values you assigned are just projections onto the axes that belong to you. Now, if someone is zipping past Earth in a high-speed rocket, they're going to disagree with you on some things. Their axes look different, so they're going to see the path between these two events differently. They would assign different values to those events, but you'll both agree about two things. The events definitely occurred, and there is a path connecting them.
What's your point, Smarty Pants?
The stuff we agree on needs to be more prominent in the diagram than the stuff we disagree on. Space-time is not the axes. It's not the projections onto those axes. It's not even the values we assign to these events. Space-time is only the events themselves and the connections between them. The axes are just math, and math is not reality. One more thing we agree on in this particular example is the order in which these events occur. Leaving home must occur before arriving at work. That might seem obvious to you, but not all events are connected like this. I mean, what I had for breakfast this morning has no influence on a particle collision at CERN. While both of those events occurred, they're not connected. Rocket Guy might even disagree with me about their order, because their order doesn't matter. What we're talking about here is causality, the relationship between cause and effect. Connections between events represent causality, and that's governed by another one of those invariants, the local speed of light. Light travels along these diagonal lines, so the connections between events must always be steeper lines. And events have been occurring since the beginning of time, forming an unimaginable network of connections. Different observers just see different three-dimensional projections of this true four-dimensional reality. In other words, we all carry our own rulers and our own clocks. Our experience of the space-time network is deeply personal. But the events are the same for everyone, and the order of cause and effect holds the universe together. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Was Gregor Mendel Austrian? He was born in Silesia, a region in the Austrian Empire. He died in Brno, Moravia, a region in the Austrian part of the dual monarchy of Austria-Hungary. European historical politics are complicated, but yeah, I think it's fair to call him Austrian. And thanks for watching. The rare triple peace sign.